to the club. We're your hosts. I'm Akila Friend.
And I'm Ebony Chapman.
And today, y'all, we know Fashion Week may have ended, but we are keeping the fashion going all month long. All right. Today, we are joined by fashion designer and founder of All Style 7, a sanctuary for one-of-a-kind garments, art, and accessories, Terrell Ransom Jr. Terrell, welcome. We are so happy to have you.
What's up? I'm actually the senior, though. There's another Terrell out there, Jr. And check it, he's more famous than I am. So.
Yes, you know what it is? I saw him on your Instagram, and I was like, you better be shouting out to Russ. This is the senior, let's get it right from the jump. So Terrell Ransom Sr. of All Style 7, so, so happy to have you.
And what a pleasure.
You know, we are going to dive in, like I said, to fashion, design. You learned fashion from the School of Hard Knocks, and there are a lot of folks who want to do the same thing, you know, not letting school or what have you stop you from pursuing your passion. And so we're going to talk about all of that. But before we get started, let's get right into the overall landscape of fashion right now. You often hear, at least we often hear from somewhat outsiders of, you know, working in the fashion world. We love a good fit, but we don't. But you also often hear that it's super catty, super superficial in the world. We all watch Devil Wears Prada. We watch, you know, Project Runway, where they say, you know, their signature phrase is one day in the world of fashion, one day you're in, and the next day you are out.
You're out of here.
Do you think this is true? And for one, do you think this is true? And then secondly, we want to know specifically from a Black male perspective, how is it really being in the fashion world?
Sure. I do believe that it is true. One day you can be in, the other you can be out. I think what's the most important thing is to be flexible in your fashion. Like, literally, you cannot stay stagnant in your style. You have to be ever evolving and ever changing. And if you're able to do that and navigate being yourself in that, you're set.
We love that. Yes, I think being versatile in your style is wonderful. Being able to change it up. I mean, trends literally happen like this. Like,
literally.
They're like flying by at all times. Like, one day it's hot pink, next day it's green, tomorrow it's print. Like, have different things to even keep up on and to keep your eye out for. So how do you stay up on trends? How do you stay with it? Because it moves fast.
Well, I learned at a very young age the importance of being yourself and being an individual. Not to get too ahead of myself, but I really got into fashion as like a young kid. You know, my parents, they didn't have the most money. And we used to go to the thrift shop, and that was where I could like ball out and be myself, wear whatever I wanted to wear. Cause it was only 99 cents, you know? So mom's like, whatever. so it's that, like, just kind of from a young age, kind of just learning to be yourself. You know, if I couldn't afford the Jordans or the Tommy Hilfiger that's been trending right now, like, you know, wearing stuff back in the day. So I had to find myself and be confident and comfortable in being myself at a very young age. And I think that's kind of where, you know, that's kind of has brought me to where I am today.
I can only imagine the idea of, like, you know, because it's one thing. I mean, it's funny how when you're younger, it's like, okay, you're the kids that go thrifting. And now it's like, no, thrifting is all the rage.
It's a thing. It's a business.
Also, but listen, Tommy Hilfiger, I heard that he not for the people. So we got to be careful about him. You know, he might get canceled. He was on the cancel list before the cancel list.
Listen, that ain't none of my business, okay? We love Tommy, though. So.
Been it, and I'm not in it.
I ain't in it.
I love that, because then it means, like, for instance, you know, you were able to, how did you build your confidence, I should say, when it comes to wearing your own unique styles from a young age? Now, when you're adults, you kind of want to be unique. You want to have your own style. But when you're a child, in some cases, you want to fit in. You want to feel like you're a part of this. You're wearing the Nike and the Jordans.
You don't want to get bullied.
You don't want to get bullied.
Yeah.
You know, because this is you did it out of necessity, but also it sounds like you had that creativity in you from the beginning.
How yeah.
did you create your own confidence in the
mix? I think for one thing that I was always able to do was I could mimic what was happening without it being that. You know what I mean? So it's like if the colors were red, white, and blue, I'm gonna have some red, white, and blue in it. It might not be that brand, but you know, I'm gonna make it. Or if it's an oversized fit that's happening, I'm gonna find those like the big puffy coats. I remember the like the big puffer coats. It didn't have to be name brand, it was just a big puffer coat. Now, of course, you're gonna have the little petty kids, bad little elementary school that's like, that ain't what you call it. But that's where you learn your confidence, like, yes, so what? But still fly.
Yes, exactly.
That's a lesson I'm gonna teach my kids.
That's it.
No, seriously.
Strong, all right?
Yeah.
I love that. So, I mean, we've also seen a rise of notable Black male designers and fashion icons in the world today. I'll name a few. You know, you have the Pyer Mosses, you have the Virgil Ablohs, you have the Telfar, Clemmons, just to name a few. What is this kind of your aspiration when it comes to fashion, or you know, just what do you have to say truly about the dominance in a sense of Black male designers in the culture?
How do you think that they were able to kind of like break that ceiling?
Yes,
because like for so long, or even now, like you know, you can only get so far, especially high fashion, seeing Black people of color in high fashion setting the trends. Mm-hmm. Like how do you think they were able to break that mold?
Well, you know, I think the gag is they haven't. And so there is a constant struggle of trying to prove yourself as a fashion person, a fashion icon. And I think that's why they are so, all of the people that you just named are like my idols. The reason why they are remaining consistent is because they're like, you know what? I don't care. I'm going to do me. And people are now constantly kind of figuring out that these people, they do know what they're talking about. And you already know, like the people been following our trends for a very long time anyway. Finally, we're starting to get credit for what we started in the first place. So,
I mean, we see that all over the place, especially in social media right now. I know like the Black TikTokers, they went on strike because no one was giving their cred. You know what I'm saying? So I think Black people, I've said it before, I'll say it again, I'm going to continue to say it. We are the trendsetters.
Period.
The seekers. Okay.
Amen. All the Amen. Amen.
Okay, we are Black creators all day, every day, and we continue to set those trends and do all of the things. She already knows where I'm going with this because I say it all the time, but that's the vibe. That's exactly how I feel. They definitely copy off of everything, get the money, make the millions, and we over here still struggling, and it's ridiculous.
Absolutely. I think it's really, though, it's fantastic that we as Black people are like actually recognizing, hey, these are people that we need to support. And I think that's what is why even myself being the little success that I'm starting to see now is because people are like, you know what? This is a thing. This is a vibe. I support what you're doing, spreading the word. And that's how we are going to be ahead of the class, being pushed by our people.
Nice.
Like the Black Creators Club. Like, you know.
Period.
Say it again.
Okay. Let's dial it back a little
Period.
Bit. What made you decide to say, you know what, I not only love fashion enough to wear it, to style myself, but I want to pursue a career as a fashion designer?
Well, I have worked in retail for years and years and years. And most recently, like over the last 10 to 13 years, I started working in the secondhand retail market, right? And I started recognizing that my choices were making people lots of money. And I started to think like, yo, I should be doing this myself, but you know, bills and benefits and all of the things that you all know, why we work, why we do what we do. And once the pandemic hit, I was still working. I wasn't off. I worked through the entire pandemic. But I started seeing people kind of like delving into their own creative lanes. And I'm like, if I may not ever get this opportunity again in this lifetime to pursue and be in a place where people are recognizing that. People are like, yes, do you? Like, we have a huge support system. And so it's like, finally, it's like, let's try this. Let's do it. And that's kind of how we ended up here today.
So many pandemic success stories, yeah. And starter stories. I mean, obviously, no one loves COVID-19 or the.
We hate it.
but what you've been able to at least start is incredible. I want to delve a little bit more. You said a lot of people getting a lot of money around what you helped or helped flourish in your 9-to-5. Like, mm-hmm. What can you share more about that? I think that's an interesting thing to note.
So I worked in the buy-sell trade industry. I'm sure there's different, you know, those companies. You know, take your clothes in, you can sell them, and
diamond shop. Mm-hmm.
Yes, and that buy. And so I was store manager, and basically, you know, a lot of my choices is what makes the money, what makes the selections that I'm choosing is going to sell. And I was able, being in that industry, I was able to see results very quickly. You know, a lot of buyers who buy for like Neiman Marcus or those type of places, you don't really see it until, you know, the end of the quarter. It's like, okay, did it work? Did it not? But like in my industry, I was able to see like buy it in for the store, and people would be like trying to get it out of the basket. Like, and I'm like, man, I really know what I'm doing. And then not only that, it was, again, the receipts were there as well. The coins were there. So it's like, I was like, man, I am doing all of this and not feeling the worth, you know, not feeling the value and where I was. And it was just like, you know, after different things, it was just kind of like, I have to at least try to do this on my own.
Yeah. And I absolutely love that. And I'm thinking about the receipts and all the things we've talked about, and, you know, with other people, or like I've had conversations with my friends, we talk about this idea of like imposter syndrome. Had like any formal background, like you're not you didn't go to FITM, you didn't go to, you know, and so the idea that you're like, okay, well, I work in the retail space and I really do love the idea of buying and selling, you know, thrifting clothes, and that's been my background, and you've had it in your space, right?
Like, mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
Formal training, you could say, or like, you know, education. So how do you push past the idea of feeling like an imposter in a space where actually you completely and totally belong?
Well, I think people need to realize the training that you get actually being in it, you know, starting from scratch, kind of getting your foot in the door, that is training, that is school, that is, you know, if you allow it to be. You know, they ask me questions, and I'm constantly asking questions. I'm learning, you know, having your fingers all up in it. That's school. It really is. And if you can recognize that, it's okay to kind of start at the ground floor, because it's like, hey, I may not be, you know, the store manager, or I may not be an executive yet. But if I can gain all of this knowledge, put it in my back pocket. Trust me, you will. The receipts are going to show for themselves. But you got to put in the work and be humble enough to accept those opportunities as a learning experience.
That's exactly. Perspective is key, and I love what you were saying in terms of you have to allow it to be, because
that's right.
Life could potentially be a teachable moment if you're ready.
Y'all ain't ready. They ain't ready out there. That's the problem.
Let's delve into that a little bit more. So again, let's say someone who is like, man, I really want to do this, but I don't have the formal training. I don't know where to start. Like, what advice would you give them to formally just enter the business? Because at least with you, you had your, you know, position, you mm-hmm. had your job to your really space. Your space to get, you know, to get the receipts and figure things out. But
yeah,
someone else who may not even be at that level yet, how can they at least enter?
Dip a toe.
Yeah.
Dip a toe
in the shallow waters.
Hey, like, no, you know, not getting paid for this at all, but like YouTube, TikTok. Seriously, like if you can really, like, you know, get your notepad out, start taking notes, watch the YouTube tutorials, like you really can learn a lot and you get a lot of knowledge that is for free. And people don't, a lot of people that just don't respect small beginnings. And the smallest beginning is just actually starting to do the research. Trust me, God is going to answer. He's going to acknowledge that if you just put in a little bit of work, just start doing some research, start getting your notepad out, and declaring what it is that you're going to do. Like I could literally testify, like I've been kind of going over notes and seeing like things are actually coming to pass, like the manifestations, they are happening, but you got to write it, you got to start somewhere. And I think that's like the smallest opportunity for learning is just kind of start doing the research.
Love that.
You better take us to church today. Okay.
It's facts. It's the truth. Yeah.
Everything you just said.
I think that's applicable to any.
I was going to say it's applicable to any industry, any way of life. Like if you just gotta research, all right? And so, like when you were first researching, what were some of the things that you're like, man, I really want to know this or that? I'm trying to get into the head of someone who wants to be Terrell. Like, what?
Well, you know, it was number one. It was acknowledging what do I really like to do? What is it that I really love? I love shopping. Shopping on a bad day is like, wow. Like, you know what I mean? So it's like finding that thing that you really, really enjoy and start then after, once you have that acknowledged, then it's like, now how can this make me money? How can it make me money? It may not make me money immediately, but like, how can I start working this and navigating this to start making my passion, you know, bring in revenue? How can you do that? And I think that, like, just again, it's the smallest thing, is just the thought. Once, if you can think it, write it out, and then put it to action and start, and you know, and connecting with people who may be in that industry, or you know, talking to people, you know, learning, listening to red flags. And you know, sometimes you have to shift your friends because some people can't get started because of who they with and who they think is really supporting them, and they're not. Like, you know, right away when you tell your homegirl, yo, I got an idea, this is what I want to do, it's either going to be that's what you want to do, you sure, or yes, go for it, that's it, I knew you had it, and I couldn't wait for you to actually take that step.
100%. Yep. You know, it's funny talking about just like energy and vibes. We were just talking about that earlier today before we next started, and they were like, we need to get some sage, some polysulfur, get all the bad energy out of our lives, because it's like people be taking your energy and you don't even realize it until they're not there anymore.
Until they're not there no more, and you're doomed. You're doomed.
I'm weak. Okay.
I mean, but you're preaching, to be honest. And I just want to, you know, you to recommend, like, again, you know, knowing what you know now and knowing where you are now, what would you recommend be in every aspiring fashion designer's starter kit? If you had to even name three things that should be in their starter kit, what would they be?
It's going to be confidence. Number one, that has to be secure. You gotta know that this is what I want to do. I would say like the second thing would be is the ability to handle letdowns and no's. If you gotta be able to handle the rejection, cause you know, even the smallest things of like, there's an opportunity for you. If that doesn't work out, baby, you got to keep going, because it's a lot of times those little small things where it's like, oh, I thought that was gonna work out, it didn't work out. And then you feel like, this is it. What am I doing out here? No. You got to be able to handle that and realize that the no may be a closed door for a reason. I would say the third thing is to You know, focus where your money is going. Like, you know, you got to have some sort of savings, some sort of fallback plan. Try to make those fallback plans at least somewhere surrounded in that industry. Like, you know what I mean? Like, okay, I may not be able to be a fashion designer right away, but let me stay in retail. Let me figure out how I can still keep my day job to make my dreams possible.
Amen. That is literally, the vibe.
Great advice.
Yeah.
Such good advice. I have people in my mind right now that I'm thinking, okay, when this interview airs, who am I sending it to? Like,
yeah.
You've been doing, oh, yes, taking us to church, yes. Preaching it all. Okay, so let's talk about your brand, okay?
Yes.
So within All Smiles 7,
all
you
styles.
Have all styles, okay?
But they have all styles.
That's right.
Collection, okay. So within All Style 7, you have a signature smiley face that you have on your nice shirt. And you also say that you thrift the items that you use to then put on your signature style. So why smiley faces and why the thrifted item?
Gotcha. Okay. So, I'll start with the canvas is what I call them. Those pieces that are thrifted, or I like to call them source, because sometimes they're not thrifted. Thrifting can have a negative connotation for people who are not in the industry, who, you know, they're just thinking like it's trash or it's sourced. These are pieces that are like specifically, I really wanted to focus on the fashion portion of it too. It's like, it's not just paint and clothes. It's actually, you got a garment and artwork at the same time. So that's like where it's kind of started. The reason why I chose to do sourced or thrifted pieces is because, you know, I'm trying to be, you know, save the footprint, the, you know, stay green, heal the planet. Like, you know, we really don't need another garment produced. We just don't. Now, it's gonna happen. We gonna buy it. You know, the new bag comes out, I'm buying it. Like, but at the same time, if there's any, you know, anything that could help, it's so many clothes out there that still have life in them. And then it was just kind of like, why not add a smile to it? So that's kind of where the smile aspect comes in. The smiles right now, that's kind of like my signature and my vibe at the moment. But there are different things. There's a lot of things up here that are going to be coming out. So right now, like the initial start is definitely the smiles, because I'm like, coming out of the pandemic, it's like, child, we got to smile. We got so much to be grateful for. And so that's what people have always said about my stuff, is like, I can't help but not smile. Like, and I'm like, that's it. That's the point.
It's super unique. It's super trendy. And obviously I love the fact that you are really tapping into, it's not even a trend of, you know, sustainable fashion, eco-friendly wear, but you know, the fact that it's now being brought to the forefront with the incredible rise of fast fashion.
And you're kind of combating it. H&M is doing like sustainable fashions.
And absolutely.
Like, mm-hmm. Yeah.
So the fact that you're doing that, I think, is incredible and something that we definitely love to highlight.
Especially, as a Black person in this industry, like I follow a lot of like the blogs and stuff, and it's a lot of white women who are at the forefront of sustainability. Fashion, and I'm like, not to break that up, like, you know, it's a whole bunch of Black people who love sourced items.
Sourced items, and doing it so well. I want to know too, I know you said like the smiley faces right now is kind of a moment, and you're opening it up to changing, but why do you think it's important to have such a unique print for your brand?
I think that, you know, I always have been one that loves to stand out without looking ridiculous. Like, and I think that's where kind of like my stylist hat tips on in this industry. It's like, okay, you definitely want to be an individual. You want to look like, you know, cool and be yourself, but you don't want to look like a clown. And that can kind of happen as well. Now, the people who want to look like a clown, that's your thing, that's specific. But overall, it's like just standout pieces, things that are bright, things that are unusual. I think that's kind of like the basis for it all.
Yeah, and that kind of like goes perfectly into the next question of kind of like, what tips would you give a designer or someone who wants to create their own signature print or own signature style? Like, what do you think they should be looking for? Because at the end of the day, like, there are, you know, there's brands, they all look alike sometimes.
Right.
They all have their same item of clothing. Maybe they're both selling the same thing. So it's like, how do you put your personal stamp mm-hmm. on your own thing? I mean, obviously you with the smiley faces, but for someone else.
Yeah, I think that it's important to, you know, again, do the research. You know, it's like smiley faces for me, it was something that was universal. I was able to put my own spin on it. There are different techniques that I use or things that I don't do that make them stand out. So for example, like I don't have any yellow faces ever. Like that's what... in my head is what making it stand out. It's like, I never use like the yellow traditional smiley face, but it's like smiley faces they're everywhere. What's so amazing is like, people are like sending me stuff. They're like, oh, this is your smile. I saw your smile. I'm like, oh, wow, it's really happening. So I think, you know, doing the research, sticking with what you love, what's really interesting is, you know, I've been doodling smiley faces for years. I have a leather jacket that I hand painted like over like 7 or 8 years ago, the same face. And it's like, it's just kind of, whatever kind of just comes to you, start researching that, seeing where the vibe takes you, seeing where it leads you, and be able to switch it up if necessary. Like, I think a lot of people, they don't have, like we were talking about before, that kind of backup plan or plan B. Like, you gotta be open and willing to switch if necessary, because there is nothing new under the sun. It's just not. Like, whatever idea that you have, trust me, somebody got it, has done it before, or is thinking about it, so.
Yes. I'm curious too then, like, for you creating this brand that really, as you said, really got its lift off during the pandemic, mm-hmm. what have been some of the highs and the lows of All Style 7?
Some of the highs, like, I mean, doing an interview today for Black Creators Club, like, you know what I mean? Like, that kind of thing is, that's high for me. That's high on my list. I've been featured in a particular campaign, a high-end campaign. Some of my work was featured in that. And again, y'all, like, I ain't trying to be like, I've been doing this for years. Like, this is right after pandemic. This has only been within a few months, but God has been good. And I'm like actually starting to see lots of benefits from it. So some of the lows have been, like I had talked about before, like, you know, those opportunities where it's like, oh, this is about to be really big. This is really about to blow you up. And it's like, oh, what happened? Oh, okay, maybe next time. But again, the highs are, I use those as fuel to keep me going over the lows, for sure.
We love that.
Love your energy. Yes. Your energy. positivity. You're just like, you are preaching right now. And because it's all about, I think, anything you do, especially when you're looking at entrepreneurship, it is like, it begins and ends with the mind. Like, it is,
yeah. For sure.
And no, because like,
her and I were talking earlier, we were just saying how, you know, Telfar, like, started in 2005, and like they just started blowing up like last year, and now Beyonce has a back. Like, you just never know what kind of vibe you're gonna
you
be.
Never on. You, you know, never know.
Runway show tomorrow, or it could, you know, it just be you never know.
You never know. And so that you just really gotta love it. That's for sure. You gotta love what you're doing. It has to be like a hobby for you, as well as something that you're trying to pursue. And I think that's the only way it's going to work, because you're working, once you start working for yourself, you are working 24 hours a day. Even after, like, once I put that paintbrush down, my mind is still thinking like, okay, so where's dinner going to come from? Now, what are we gonna eat? Like, you're constantly working. So if it's not your true love, it's not gonna work. Trust.
Really? If you don't stop it, okay? Because I've literally been on that rise. Like, first of all, I've been saying I'm now doing a meal prep service to like have food. I don't have time to. We're not gonna eat if we don't, like, just no time. We started doing like 5 a.m. meetings. We're like, if we're putting 40 hours a week into someone else's pockets, like, we have to at least do half that time for us.
Yes.
So we're doing 5 a.m. meeting. You're like meeting at night. We're, this is like, Sundays are our day to just do everything. So it is, you're right. It's a constant situation, a 24-hour job. When you're not physically doing it, your mind's still doing it.
You're still working. So when I lay down, I'm like, I'm thinking about, okay, what's the next canvas that I'm going to use? Or, you know, who can I send this to? Who can I, you know, put this in front of? Like, you're constantly working. So it's like, it's not easy, but if it can be something that's almost like a hobby to you, it's going to be fun, and you're going to find the fun in it. You're going to find the joy in those tired days. You're gonna find joy in it. If it's truly something that you love, and you're not just trying to be on this trend of, I'm a Black entrepreneur.
Woo! We can talk about that.
Like, this ain't no hashtag, babe. Like, this is real life. It's real life.
Yes, yes. And with that, I mean, because I think in fashion, like media, relationships seem to be key. All right.
Yeah.
It sounds like you were talking, alluding to it earlier, in terms of you just going out and trying to, you know, meet people in the space. But I'm so curious for someone like you who didn't have that built-in, oh my gosh, we all went to school together, class of 2009.
Yeah.
Now you're at this place or that place, or we're not all on the runways together. How do you make those connections, keep those connections, and build your brands together?
I think, you know, you have to be in spaces where you are going to either be appreciated or you're going to be able to gain knowledge from, right? If you can get that down, like, I just need to show up there. Maybe I might have to invest in that ticket so that people can see me smiling. Like, you know what I mean? Even like, just like us, like meeting in those kind of those spaces where it's like, you know, I might have to bite the bullet because this is important. It's going to be people there who need to see this that may not follow me on Instagram, or the Instagram algorithm ain't acting right. And okay, that's a whole nother. But you know what I mean? Like, it's like, you have to kind of put yourself in those spaces where your tribe is. My stuff is not for everybody. I recognize that. I understand that some people don't like to wear used clothes. I get that. Some people don't want bright, you know, I understand that. But there is a tribe of people that is for me. And if you can get that in your spirit, like, you'll be okay. But like, you gotta kind of like put yourself out there and not be afraid of doing it either.
Hashtag find your tribe.
Find it.
I love that. And what he's referring to, Terrell, we met him at an event that Akil and I went to, Everyday People. And honestly, him and his friend were both wearing the outfits, and it just caught our eye. And we were just like, oh my God.
These are people we want to meet.
Yeah, it's
who are like Black creators in flesh.
Yeah. That's what we're
all about. My tribe, see?
love that. How about you? Like, bring it home. Who is the All Style 7, you know, person? What is the persona? What do they like? Or who are you marketing mainly to?
Gotcha. So it's a unisex brand. It's for men and women. A lot of times I will mark on my website specifically that if the item is unisex, so that it can kind of open people's mind up to, it's for everyone, number one. Again, the All Style 7 fashionista is someone who loves fashion, who loves unique pieces, people who like to stand out, and people who, you know, the thrift community is deep. Like, I mean, people be fighting over stuff. People are standing in line for something that is, you know, one of a kind. A lot of times it becomes one of a kind because it's, you know, made in the 80s and you'll never see that again. So it's that type of person who is like looking for those like individual pieces, wants to stand out. And then they want to support Black business. So that's who it's for.
What about the people that want to support Black business?
I mean, for real, like that's the biggest thing. So
love that. You know what? And it's good to know your market. It's like this. Yeah. Get into it, okay?
Absolutely, absolutely.
Okay, go ahead.
I was going to say, like, your overall mission then, like, when it comes to fashion, when it comes to your brand, when it comes to kind of what you're really doing and portraying through All Style 7, what's your overall mission?
I think for me, it is, you know, those people who were like, you know, I'm tired of just the regular. Like, because that's just where I started. That, and I think that's who my tribe is, for people who are tired of conforming to the regular. And they want to be, again, they want to stand out. They want to show people that they have individual style. Like, again, that's what it's all about. And I think that's the mission. And then actually bring people into the idea of like trying to save the planet through the things that you purchase. Like, you know, save that t-shirt from that particular company. Keep that on the hanger. How about you put on this blazer that nobody else is ever going to have? It's yours specifically. Like that's the mission.
I love that. Why do you think it's so important for folks to really get into like sustainable fashion and just eco-friendly wear?
Because the earth is on fire. And like seriously, like it's a lot.
5 minutes ago, like wait,
like for real. So seriously, so it's like we got to do every little bit that we can. Sure, you know, I was reading this article and they were talking about how a lot of things that you put in the recycle bin doesn't get recycled, right? So it's like wherever we can find something to try to help and hold on to, like let's try to support that. And like I said, people, you're already buying clothes. How about giving something a new life? And I think that's the biggest picture right there. Let's give something a new life and show your own personal style through that as well.
Yeah, and you know, it's so crazy because like with recycling, I'm like not a fanatic, but I'm a little psycho about it.
Yeah.
I have guilt like putting it in the trash can. So like water bottles at work, I will literally take the empty bottles and put them in my backpack until I get home because I know like I recycle at home. And
so absolutely,
that weirdo that's gonna have like 10 water bottles. I'm guilty throwing them away. Like
go, girl, keep it up.
Only to find out these corporations are like, nope, we're not going to do that for y'all.
Exactly.
We got you, but the rest.
I know. And honestly, that makes me want to be even more sustainable. Yes. Like even with, you know, clothes, but like with silverware, like I bring my little portable silverware with me. So I'm not eating plastic. So just
it's
like
a small thing. Small things. Yeah.
You can do. I'm gonna plug here that still take your showers once a day.
Okay. No,
okay. We not saying that.
Nobody said that at all.
No, listen, they were saying that. Don't wait till you see the dirt. Okay. Please shower.
Please do it.
Please. For us.
Water will be recycled at like shower.
Figure it out.
So what is like the overall what is the overall next step for All Style 7?
It's to keep going, keep pushing. You know, celebrities wearing my stuff, that's That's the big thing. If you go to my Instagram right now, you can kind of see, like, I've been doing like these mock-ups, yeah, like fashion inspos and concepts, like, because I can see celebrities in myself.
I can, yes, see Rihanna wearing your shit.
Like, I can see it. So yes, that's next.
I think that's incredible. That's incredible. What does, you know, like I said, we teed it up at the beginning. This is all about creating wearable art, and you are doing it well. So
thank you.
What does creating wearable art mean to you?
It is like, it's the sweat, it's the bent over, it's on your knees painting. It's the soul of it. Like, you know, some people don't have access to Black art. They just don't. Like, they, money, whatever the reasons are, they don't have access to it. I want to be able to give people an opportunity to support Black art through fashion. And so that's like my mission there, is like, you know, giving people an opportunity to support like Black artists. And it's like, you actually like, that's dope. And he's like, yo, a Black guy did this. That's fire. I would love to say that.
We're going to continue to say that, yes, here at the Black Creators Club, because literally that's all we do all day is talk to
all Black day.
Creators, doing Black things, doing Black shit, killing it in their spaces, okay? And in fact, talking about Black art, we also had Cecilia's house. Hang Black art on your house, honey. So you guys still get 15% off on that one.
Yes.
Guys, don't forget to continue to support us, because we love you guys so much for continuing to watch, subscribe, like, comment, to do all those things. We are on Instagram at the Black Creators Club. We are also on YouTube at the Black Creators Club. If you want to be a guest, or you know someone, or want to recommend someone to be a guest, you can email us, theblackcreatorsclub@gmail.com. You guys, we are just so excited to continue. Like, literally, this is why we do what we do. Yes, like, these amazing stories,
incredible
these
example.
Amazing people doing this. Amazing things, and Ben being Black, because yes, that's what we do. Okay,
that's, I mean, if we don't do nothing else, we gonna be Black.
we gonna be black, and we gonna be creative. Because yes,
period. We can't help it.
That's it. And I love that you, this is Black art. I mean, it's Black art, it's Black fashion. It is, I mean, it's everything. And so you kind of teed it up earlier. Your next step for you is kind of dressing celebrities, or having celebrities in All Style 7. And so
yeah,
we got a little game for you.
It's okay.
Dressed for the Gawds.
Love it already.
Yes. So we know many designers live for that moment when they get to work with A-list celebrities. So we're going to pick two celebrities, and it's up to you to decide which one out of those two you'd rather style. Obviously, I mean, you'd love both, but we're just going to pick, you know, pick one of
them
that you'd rather style, and what outfit you would choose for them. It could be something from your own collection. It could be something that you just know. It can just be an idea of something that you know they would look good in, but we just want to, you know, pick your brain a little bit with this.
Love it.
Yeah, so the first two that you have to choose, one celeb that you would go for, it's either Michael B. Jordan or Mr. Yahya Abdul-Mateen. Which one would you choose? And Yahya, you should know, but it's Candyman is his most recent.
Yeah. Okay, so I'm going to say Yahya because, like, I feel like that's the aesthetic for this kind of stuff. Like, I could easily see him doing an editorial shoot in like a full-on Black suit that has smiles all on it, no shirt, open chain, easy. Yeah.
Emphasize on the no shirt.
Yes.
No shirt.
Michael, I got you though. I do got you, Michael.
We yes, love that. Mm-hmm. Okay, so your next two choices of celebrity is SZA or Jhené Aiko.
SZA. Ooh. Yeah, because like, I see the hair really big. I see her in like an oversized blazer as a dress. You know, bright colors, natural fiber blazer. Mm-hmm. definitely SZA for me.
SZA with the hair and the look.
It's a statement.
Yeah. She would kill it. That's true. Okay, the next one, and this is from inspiration from some of your latest posts.
So okay.
The next two that you'll choose between, Beyonce or Kylie Jenner, which one out of the two will you be like, okay, this is the one?
Yeah, it's Beyonce. I mean, come on now.
Easy.
No, but you know what? The reason, like, specifically, it's because Beyonce, hands down, is supporting Black creatives and, like, those up-and-coming brands. Like, that's her thing. So, Beyonce, call me. Where can I send it?
Listen, and once you get on that PR box from Ivy Park, I'm gonna plug it every time. Call us.
Look, I got you. I got a keychain for y'all or something. You know
what? That's a keychain.
Yeah, we will do that.
We'll take it here.
Booches.
So good.
I am weak. Okay, so your next choice of celebrity is Kamala Harris or Michelle Obama?
Dang, they're both so good. Michelle.
I kind of knew
Michelle. Because you know what? And like, I would choose Michelle because it's like, she does take some fashion risks. Like, I gotta let, you know, Vice President Harris be her. She needs to be an executive right now, right? Michelle is like, I ain't with y'all no more. What it do? So I can see her having like a lot of fun, like a night out with President Obama in a smiley fit, yeah, for sure.
That's true. And you know what? That's what it's all about. It's all about the season. Right now, it's not Kamala's season.
Yeah, no. You got to be the president right now.
And the last two choices we've got for you.
Okay.
It's either a certified lover boy, Drake, or Donda, aka Kanye West.
I already know.
Which one do you got?
So I would love to do Kanye.
Yes.
I would love to do Kanye because it's like I can totally see him again. Oversized blazer with like hand painted stuff all on it. He got his Yeezy. I see it. So it's definitely Kanye. That's it. He has a mask on, a ski mask. So might put some smileys on that too.
Absolutely kill it. Absolutely.
He might kill it because Kanye is like, he's a fashion risk taker and like he's really
in the
fashion game. Like Drake is like, he's just like, you know, stylish.
But yes.
Kanye likes to take risks and, you know, with the mask, that's the whole thing. Like he gets it. He's just super into like all the designers and all the things.
One of my favorite lines from Kanye is like the paparazzi is following him and he's like, do you see this coat? Like, that's a fashionista. You see this coat? Yeah.
And he's into his vibe at all times.
At all times.
Best believe.
He put the same.
That's right. This is fashion.
Correct. Hello. We can get another keychain. It's gonna be easy on it.
I love it.
That's it. That's all for Dress for the Gossip. Oh. You did so well. I love it.
Thank you. So fun.
Yes, Terrell Ransom Sr. Mm-hmm. Let our listeners know where they can find you and anything else, perhaps anything else that you want to share about what you're doing, what's next. This is your moment.
Sure. My website is allstyle7.com. There's new stuff popping up there weekly, or my Instagram is allstyle7 as well. So that's where you can find me. I am residing in those places right now. I just think that, you know, the biggest thing is keep supporting your Black creative community. It's really important. I mean, just even if it's just a share, it's a tag to somebody that you know, it's like that goes such a long way. And it keeps us, you know, creators moving and popping. It's out of me today. That that can take you to the next place. So keep supporting, keep supporting, keep tagging, keep sharing, keep liking, and just letting the Black creators know that, you know, you got your, they, you got their back, even if it's not financially. Like, we gotta let that go, because it's like, sometimes the coin don't line up, but if the support is there, you can make it.
Yeah, that's true. And I think that's such a good thing to say, like, you know.
But buy stuff, though. For sure.
Period. That's it. I mean, this is amazing. You can find me chatting everything the media industry, as well as life motivation, all with a dash of style, at Akila Friend. Ebony, where can they find you?
Yes, you guys can find me chatting everything Black owned business, and of course the Black Creators Club at Ebony Chapman 12 on Insta.
Yes, and again, you can find us chatting and supporting Black creatives all on the Black Creators Club at the Black Creators Club on all platforms. Thank you so, so much for joining us. And remember to always abide by your ABCs. Always be creating. Thanks. There we go.
Oh my gosh.